everybody. Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. Election season is fast approaching, and with it, potential presidential candidates are lining up for the most powerful job in the world.
While candidates are still being decided, many politicians are looking at the new swing voter, young evangelical Christians. Recently, we asked students at a Christian university to tell us which party they identify with, and this is what they had to say.
As an evangelical, I'm a registered Republican, but that does not mean that that platform is my only view.
I don't think that I'm committed to any particular platform.
I do vote Republican most of the time, but I consider myself more conservative than Republican.
Typically, I'm guided by my spiritual beliefs.
When it concerns immigration, however, I think I'm definitely way more moderate.
I think my political stances kind of come from my Christian worldview.
I'm pro-life.
I believe it's our duty as evangelical Christians to give, and it will be given unto us.
I am definitely supportive of education and healthcare reform. So I don't think that I'm necessarily Democratic or Republican.
Well, for more on this topic, please welcome the Dean at the School of Theology at Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, Russell Moore. Russell, welcome to 700 Club Interactive.
Good to be with you.
We've seen a shift now in voting trends of young evangelicals. What's caused it?
Well, I'm not sure if there's a shift in the voting trends as much as it is in the way that young evangelicals identify themselves. And so I think some young evangelicals have been disappointed in the way that maybe some in the older generation have put so much emphasis and hope in the political process. And younger evangelicals are more complicated when it comes to the issues than they are simply in lockstep with any given platform or party.
Are we in danger of literally throwing away the gospel in exchange for a political campaign? Is that what's concerning them?
I think that many are seeing that that has happened in many cases, in which you have, in some sectors of evangelicalism, the political agenda is more important than the gospel itself. At least that's what gets the blood flowing, and that's what gets the direct mail going and the people enthusiastic. And so younger evangelicals who are really fighting against a secularizing culture by embracing the gospel, Jesus Christ raised from the dead and forgiving of sin, are very, very skeptical of anything that's going to detract from that. And I think they're precisely right. I think that for too long, we have seen a political agenda seeking a gospel useful enough to sustain it on both the right and the left. And it's time that we move beyond that.
It's almost like we've gotten adopted a slogan, repent and be registered.
It's
part and parcel of it. From your standpoint, how do we move away from that? And why would it be important to move away from that?
Well, I think the first thing we need to do is to understand that the gospel is about more than simply our seeking to differentiate ourselves from others in the culture. So I think there needs to be a change in tone where we're no longer angry at the people around us. We're instead seeking to be redemptive toward them. I think that's important. I think the second thing is to move to understanding that we're seeking within our churches to shape and to form consciences, which means that we deal first with our own sins. You think about what the New Testament says. The Apostle Paul writes to the church at Corinth, I'm judging those on the inside, not those who are out in the world. And I think in evangelical circles, sometimes we tend to reverse that. We want to talk about the things that we see out there in the culture, but not to address the things that are very close to us, things like divorce and consumerism and marriages that are very different from an Ephesians 5 pattern. And so I think we need to start concentrating on where are we being changed within our own churches before we start seeking political solutions to everything.
Are the political issues for this, I guess, for lack of a better term, for the young evangelicals, is that changing, where in previous generations it's been right to life and those kinds of issues, family values, are the issues changing?
I don't think that you're going to see younger evangelicals changing on the sanctity of human life issue. Where I think you're going to see a change is that young evangelicals are going to see the pro-life issue as being distinct and transcendent, where maybe another generation would have put the right to life issue in a whole package, so that if I'm pro-life, that means I also have certain economic views and certain immigration views and certain views of foreign policy. Younger evangelicals are going to be committed to the right to life, to the vulnerable, the unborn, but they're also going to have more ongoing discussions about how to minister to vulnerable orphans and sex trafficked women and those who are being persecuted overseas and those who are facing ecological catastrophe. And so I think the pro-life issue is going to be distinct, and then there's going to be a lot of discussion and conversation beyond that.
Both parties, both Democrats and Republicans, are seeming to reach out to these new voting blocks. What are they doing to capture this vote?
Well, I think both the Democratic and Republican parties are reaching to their own constituencies and not really reaching to those who aren't as readily identifiable with either of those parties. And so I think you can see the standard religious right activists around the Republican Party, and you see the standard religious left activists around the Democratic Party. And I think in order to reach maybe a new generation of evangelicals, both of those parties are going to have to start speaking in some different ways. And so I think you're going to have to see more complicated ideologies coming from either of the parties if they're going to be able to address younger evangelicals.
Last question is sort of a really broad one. What do you see for the future here in America? Do you have hope, or... You know, it seems like we have a lot of problems. There seems to be a huge division. There doesn't seem to be ability to even get together on some basic, what I would call the financial issues facing us. What do you see?
Well, I don't have a lot of hope when it comes to the political party structure in America right now, because I do think you see a lot of divisiveness there and moving further and further apart. When it comes to the Christian church, however, I can't help but be optimistic. Jesus says, I'm going to build my church no matter what. And I think that you're seeing some really, really hopeful signs as churches are beginning to become more and more concentrated upon being centered around the gospel and moving their people out on mission. I think you're going to see churches that are being transformed, and those churches then transforming their communities by reaching their neighbors with the gospel.
Wonderful word. Of his government, there will be no end.
That's right.
All right. Russell, thank you so much for being with us.
Good to be with you. Thank you.
All right. Terry, over to you.
Coming up, it's a super Sweet 16 birthday party, but not like the one seen on MTV. Find out how one girl's gift made it all the way to Africa.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were going to die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. And I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking, came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they save my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Well, many teenage girls look forward to their sweet 16 parties, and Devin was no different. But she threw an unusual birthday bash that started in New York and ended in Africa.
Devin Leondis is a typical 16-year-old girl, going to school and hanging out with her friends. But for a teenager, Devin's priorities are a little different than most.
Ever since I was in third grade, God just put Africa on my heart, and ever since then, I've always wanted to do something there. I found out about the Operation Blessings Well program when I was watching the 700 Club, and I always thought it was really cool that you could build a well and help people.
When Devin's 16th birthday rolled around, she knew exactly what gift she wanted most.
Well, when my mom and I went to go make the invitations, at the bottom we put, in lieu of gifts, make a checkout to Operation Blessings. And at my party at the end, we put a little clip of the wells just to show people where their money was going and how it changed other people's lives. And a lot of people asked what Operation Blessing was, so it was a good opportunity for me to talk to them and tell them about it.
Devin hoped to raise enough money to build one well, but the results were more than she ever dreamed.
We were hoping to raise $1,800 because that's how much a well is, but we raised almost $7,000, so we were so excited.
Devin was thrilled when she and her father traveled to Ghana. The village made her queen for a day, and she met the people whose lives were changed by the wells.
You may not think you can make a difference, but you can, and God will bless you back for everything you give to others.
We can all make a difference. Every one of us has the power and the capacity to touch the lives of other people if we'll just choose to. Devin is 16 years old, and she's touching many lives in Africa. And my guess is that having tasted the joy of giving, this will be a part of her life forever. We want to invite you to taste the joy of giving as well. You can be a part of this kind of radical change in the lives of people who have so little. This was a scenario where she was able to bring clean water to an entire village. We want to invite you to be able to do the same. She's told you it's about $1,800 to drill a well usually, but what we can do when we all join together is we can all do that en masse. We can have a well drilling party. We want you to be a part of changing the world as well. You can do that by giving your best gift. Call 888-777-1999, or you can log on to cbn.com and give that way. But the world is waiting for you and I to reach out with hands of love and compassion and give what God gives us to give. You know, that's all that we are asked, is to give what we're able to. And so we ask you to join with us in that today. Well, abortion is still a major political issue for young evangelicals. And when we come back, you're going to meet a girl who was supposed to be aborted. Don't miss her story of survival after this.
This is the information retailers don't want you to know, especially now. They don't want you to learn just how much money you've been giving away to retail markups on items you purchase for your home, all because you don't know how to buy like the insiders do at Direct Buy Club, the home improvement and furnishings club with direct insider prices.
When you go to Direct Buy, you know that things are going to be a lot less than retail, and you don't have to worry about sales. It's just, you know, one price, and it's a low price too.
I would shop around and investigate, and without a shadow of a doubt, Direct Buy would have the lowest price.
Members buy top quality name brand merchandise from hundreds and hundreds of trusted manufacturers. So call the number on your screen now and we'll rush you your free visitor's pass to your local Direct Buy Club and your certificate for a free 30-day membership. This is a limited offer, so call now.
Claire Culwell always knew she was adopted, and at the age of 20, she decided to find her birth mother. When they met, Claire heard the story of her birth, and it changed the course of her life. Watch this.
My name is Claire Culwell, and I am an abortion survivor, and that is how I have been affected, which is very rare. I was a twin when I was in the womb, but today I'm still a twin. My twin just isn't here. I am here to be able to be a voice and a face for the unborn. And that is all by God's grace. I will speak in honor of you. At the age of 20, I decided that I was going to make the phone call to my adoption agency and start a search to hopefully meet my birth mother. I received a phone call from her a month later, and I visited. I had a card for her, and on the card, what I wrote was, "Thank you for choosing life for me. That's the greatest gift I've ever received." And as she opened this card, what were very, very happy tears began to turn into very sad tears as well. And she grabbed my hand and she took me into a back room and she began telling me about her life. What she told me was she grew up in a family where her parents were divorced. She lived with her mother, and her mother worked multiple jobs, which left my birth mother making very adult decisions for herself. As she sought outside for love, for fulfillment, like many of us do, she found herself pregnant at 13 years old. Her mother said that there was only one thing to do. And that day, they got in the car. They drove to an abortion clinic, and my birth mother had a surgical abortion at 5 months along. After having her surgical abortion that day, as she went home to her, I believe, eighth grade life, she was in gym class with her best friend, I believe about 4 weeks later, and her friend said, "Have you been back to the doctor? Things don't seem right. Maybe you should go get yourself checked out and make sure that nothing else is wrong." And so she had her mom take her back to the same abortionist to examine her. And at that moment, she was told the most shocking words she had ever heard in her entire life: "You're still pregnant. Your abortion was successful, but you're still pregnant. You were pregnant with twins. One was aborted, but one has survived, and so you're still mothering a child in your womb." She was told that her amniotic fluid, which is in the sac and which is what holds the baby together and gives the baby nutrients, had been broken. My birth mother delivered a little baby girl 2 weeks later, and that was me. When I was born, I weighed 3 pounds, 2 ounces. My hips were dislocated and my feet were turned in as club feet. I had to stay in the hospital for 2.5 months. I was on life support. When I was released, I had casts on my feet to correct my club feet, and I had a harness on my hips to hopefully put my hips back into place. And through the next couple years, I went through multiple casts, even body casts, to kind of form my body back together, although it sounds like a horror story, and many have said, "Well, aren't you angry?"
aren't you upset? And I say no, because my birth mother is probably my biggest hero. Because she didn't have to tell me. And through her courage and through her strength and her selflessness, people's lives are being changed. Abortion doesn't just affect one person, it's a domino effect. And even though that happened, it has turned into something so beautiful. God has really taught me to rely on Him, that this is not about me, that it's about Him, it's about His grace, and it's about His amazing gift of life that He has given us. Even though life looks like a given, because we all have it, it's a gift. He is able to speak through my story and through my birth mother's story, through my parents' story, and share that gift with the world. I will not be silent.
Her voice speaks clearly and loudly, doesn't it? You know, the Bible says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. It says that God knew us before we were ever formed in our mother's wombs. And then there's this promise to us. He says, I know the plans that I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans for a hope and a future. We are designed by the Creator of the universe. Life is a precious gift. And He says also to us, this day I set before you life and death. Choose life. Choose life. There's always an answer to your problem. Doesn't matter whether you're facing the issue of abortion or whether you're in such desperation that you're contemplating taking your own life. Life is a gift. Life is a gift, and the answer to all of your needs is in the giver. You see, Claire's needs in her life, her understanding of who she is, that clear picture she has of the value of life, doesn't come because her birth mother had her act together. Her birth mother's honesty is now allowing Claire to tell the story of what she knows to be true. Her act is together because she has come to know the one who created her, because her identity is wrapped up in His love, in the way that He sees her, in His provision for her, in His saving her. In the womb, yes, but spiritually as well. And that's available to each and every one of us. So whether you find yourself pregnant in a desperate situation today, addicted to something that's ruining your life, having lost someone or something that makes you feel like there's no hope for tomorrow, you're looking to the wrong place for your answers. Jesus is who you need. And He's available. That's the great news. He loves you. He created you with hope for a future, with plan, with purpose in mind. He created you carefully, knows every hair on your head, knows you intimately more than anyone else ever will, and loves you wholly, even your lumps. He loves the things that aren't pretty about us. He loves our shortcomings. He loves us in spite of our sin. He came to set us free from all of that. He came to heal us so that we could have abundant life. Abundant life, not just live, but abundant life. God loves you so much. How do you get there from here? You stop right where you are, and you look to Him in every way. And you say, Jesus, I need you. I want you just like you love and want me. I love and want you. And today, I'm asking you to be my Savior. I'm asking you to forgive my sins, as many as they are. As much as I've done wrong, knowing I've been doing wrong, please forgive me, Jesus. And then be the Lord of my life. Teach me who you are, who I am in you. How do I live for you and with you and in you and you in me? And empower me with your Holy Spirit so that I can live abundantly, victoriously, fully and completely as you intended for me to. Ask him. That's what prayer is. It's just talking with the one who created you with more love than you can imagine. There is nothing that can separate you from the love of God except your own choice not to receive it. But his love is big, it's real, and it's available. Speak to him today. Talk to him right now, right where you're at. And if you want someone to pray with you, there's a number there. It's toll free, 888-777-1999. Call and pray with someone today. Jesus is waiting for you. Gordon?
It's time to take some ministry calls. Here's Maggie from Iowa. Hi, Maggie.
Hi, Gordon. I'd like you to pray for a reversal of my osteoporosis diagnosis. I have a lot of painful clicking in the shoulders and back.
Uh-huh.
And the second thing, complications from back fusion surgery a couple of years ago with sciatica down the leg and SI joint problems. Even though I'm in my early 50s, I move like a 90-year-old lady. I have no flexibility or range of motion. And it's just painful to sit for an extended period. And if I may be so bold as to ask for a cure of that, just the hardware to disappear so I have a new and improved spine.
Maggie, being bold is what Christianity is all about. Jesus made it so that we can go boldly to the throne of grace and receive mercy. You're in pain right now, aren't you?
Yes.
And you've got numbness?
Uh-huh.
All right. It's in the right leg?
Yes.
All right. In Jesus' name, we speak to that nerve, release now. And we speak healing and no more tingling and no more numbness and no more pain now. Amen. In the name of Jesus. We speak to this bone loss. Stop. And we speak to the bones, be restored now. We speak to the back, be restored. We ask that the hardware be removed and be replaced by what God intended. God made backs to move and be limber. God made Maggie to have movement and to dance before him. And so we just ask for that in Jesus' name. Let the joy of the Lord be her strength. In the name of Jesus, mm-hmm. Be healed and be restored.
Thank you.
Amen.
Maggie, can you be real brave for me?
I'll try.
Can you stand up?
Yes.
Okay. Can you start moving around?
Okay.
How's your leg?
A little better. The foot's still kind of numb.
Okay, but is there new firmness in your thigh and leg? The numbness is gone there?
Yeah, it seems to be. Yes.
Yeah, and we just ask it to keep on extending down.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Okay, now start twisting your torso a little bit. Is that better?
Yeah, I think so. I'm just tentative. It's just.
All right, feet were made to feel. And so in Jesus' name, full feeling in that right foot right now, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay. Amen. All right, now stomp on it.
Okay.
How's that feel, Maggie?
Pretty good.
Yeah. You haven't been able to do that in a while.
No.
All right. Now just start moving around more.
Okay.
You got to train your muscles back for the new Maggie.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you. Thanks for calling.
Bye-bye.
That's all the time we have. We leave you this wonderful word from Romans. Oh, what a wonderful God we have. How great are his riches and wisdom and knowledge. God bless you. We'll see you again.